Hi, my name is Brant Dodson. I am an atmospheric scientist at NASA Langley Research Center who uses globe data in my research. I'd like to talk for a little bit about the data that you collect, how I use that data, and why your dedication and enthusiasm for collecting and reporting weather data is so helpful for my research. I've always been a cloud watcher, as far back as I can remember. I grew up in Texas, and I had lots of opportunities to watch the daily summer cycle of fair weather cumulus clouds in the morning grow into raging cumulonimbi in the afternoon, providing a bit of relief from the Texas afternoon heat before decaying away at sunset. During my undergraduate study in Oklahoma, I had the opportunity to do a bit of storm chasing. And when I was in graduate school at Colorado, I was part of the local weather observing station where I would report my observations of clouds and weather occurring over the weekends. So I have some experience with watching the skies, and I know just how challenging it can be to accurately report all the different cloud and sky conditions that can occur. I came to NASA Langley in 2014 to research the properties of clouds using NASA satellites in conjunction with other meteorological data sets. My overall goal was, and still is, to help the scientific community better understand the interactions between clouds and their meteorological environments, such as how clouds are affected by temperature, humidity, and so on. I began by looking at cumulonimbus clouds occurring over the Amazon rainforest, but more recently I have studied clouds in other regions, such as over the Beaufort Sea, north of Alaska. Clouds have a major role in not only in short-term weather, but also in regulating long-term climate change. We scientists need to understand how clouds behave all around the world, and we need to use every tool at our disposal to give us the best information about cloud properties as we can acquire. Along with my previous experiences watching the sky, this is why I've become interested in the Globe Clouds Project and the data that you collect. I first became involved with using Globe Clouds data shortly after the 2017 Great American Total Solar Eclipse. I saw totality out in Idaho, traveling out there on my own volition, and shortly after, I was offered the opportunity to examine the meteorological properties of the eclipse using globe data collected specifically for the event. I was able to show a connection between the cloud cover during the eclipse with the temperature drop induced by the passing lunar shadow. More recently, I have been looking at the data collected during the Spring Cloud Challenge of 2018 and the Fall Cloud Challenge of 2019. Because these challenges were worldwide events, I was able to show how the distribution of clouds changes from region to region of Earth. One of the greatest advantages of Globe Clouds data is the satellite matching component, where your reports are linked with meteorological satellite data from both geostationary and low Earth orbits. This provides a comprehensive view of clouds from below and above. Using the satellite match data, I have shown that both globe participants and satellites agree closely on the distribution of cloud cover across the planet. This was a really exciting find that I was not expecting. As I mentioned, I have firsthand experience reporting weather as a ground observer, and I know how difficult it can be. So to see this close agreement between your reports and the satellites is a testament to the great work that you guys are doing. My most recent project with the Cloud Challenge data is examining the cloud cover and opacity by altitude using Globe Clouds data and comparing it with the satellite data. Weather and climate are sensitive to the vertical distribution of clouds, and scientists are really interested in measuring it. But these measurements can be tricky. You might think that these are NASA satellites and satellites from other scientific organizations. They can somehow magically see everything. So what help can ground observers provide? It turns out a lot, actually, because the satellites miss a fair bit of what's happening. For example, the satellites have difficulty seeing thin cirrus and cirrostratus clouds, whereas globe participants can more readily spot them. The satellites also cannot see clouds that occur low to the ground and are overlapped with clouds occurring higher up, which block the view of the satellites. You all can see these low clouds easily, and sometimes that's the only thing you can see. So it is a great help to me when you report cloud cover and cloud opacity by altitude. I know it's a bit more work, and it can be tough sometimes to estimate altitude, but it is really useful for helping scientists understand the details of clouds that can affect future climate. Related to this work, one of my most important goals is determining the certainty range of the data, and the results based on the data. The reports you send in are different from measurements taken by satellites, from ground stations, and other scientific instrument sources. The main issue here is that the scientific instrument data are highly calibrated and are usually much more precise than citizen science data. And this is an important issue indeed. I've been to major science conferences and listened to well-established research scientists who ask questions about how far citizen science data can be trusted and results based on that data. So I've been looking into this, and the good news is that what citizen science data lacks in calibration, it makes up for in volume. The strength of citizen science data lies in the number of participants willing to provide lots of observations to help improve the science. I've been working on some experimental procedures to study this, and what I find over and over again is that as the number of observations provided to globe clouds increases, the messiness of the results drops dramatically. All the various uncertainties in your reports tend to average out, leaving a reliable set of results. I think this sort of research is going to be very helpful in promoting the use of citizen science within the professional scientific community going on into the future. So I can demonstrate quantitatively that the more people are willing to help out with globe clouds, and the more reports that you are willing to send in, the more reliable my scientific results become. So I'm greatly appreciative of all of your time and effort in participating in this event, and whenever else you can. And these results also show that you don't have to be too worried about sending in an observation if you aren't quite sure what kind of clouds you're seeing. Again, I know that the sky can sometimes be really complex and hard to describe, and it can be tough to figure out exactly what you're seeing. So just report the best that you can, and don't worry if you might be a little off. You're not going to hurt the science. So go have fun and tell us what you see.